One of the contributing factors to low birth weight babies is the drug crack. Pregnant women who take this addictive drug run the risk of jeopardizing the health of their newborn. Operation Rescue, which is calling today a national day of rescue, is hoping the Supreme Court will come to their rescue and overturn Roe versus Wade, the 1973 Supreme Court decision legalizing abortion. Michael Milken will answer the charges next week in Manhattan's federal court. He's expected to plead not guilty. It's still not clear whether this case will go to trial. Some experts feel that despite the indictment, it may be settled out of court. I'm Shahab Sharify reporting.
In tonight's follow-up report, Shahab Sharify caught up to the runaways who are being forced to run away again.
There's no one home at the salt mine. It is empty and quiet, but the rats are still here, feeding off the foul garbage piled on top of the mountain of salt. This is home to dozens of runaway teenagers, mostly male prostitutes. They call it the salt mine because that's where the city sanitation department stores salt for the winter. But today, there's no one home.
When I came here, I had orders to have the shed cleaned out, and I had to move the kids out of the shed, which I did about 6:30 this morning.
So where are the salt mine girls, as the young men call themselves, if they're not at home? Where did they go? How will they live? Yesterday, in our report, we showed what life was like in the salt mine.
What are you guys cooking?
Chicken.
Chicken?
It went in the garbage. You find it in the garbage.
You found it in the garbage?
Yes.
Where is Sharon, the drag queen? Where are Dennis and Floyd? Why were they kicked out? Because, according to Robert Miller, the salt mine isn't fit for a dog.
Only ones that live in there is rats and the kids. Dogs don't even come around here anymore. That's how bad it is.
As sanitation workers clean the garbage from the salt mine, we caught up with Sharon, who was in the neighborhood. Sharon is a man dressed as a woman. He's lived off and on in this salt warehouse for the past 2 years. Life for Sharon is turning one trick after another. His customers are men.
I'm not a $5 girl, as you might say.
What are you?
40 and up.
This 20-year-old spends all his money on coke and crack. He was here early this morning when the salt mine girls were thrown out.
We left because of a choice, either jail. If it wasn't for the police, we wouldn't have left.
Sharon realizes that the days of the salt mine are numbered, so he spent much of the morning looking for other places for the boys to live. He says he found one.
It's just like this with no salt. It's an abandoned warehouse. That's it.
A little safer environment, perhaps less rats?
No rats. It's not on the waterfront.
Sharon wouldn't tell me the location of the new home, but he said it's not far from the salt mine, which means it's not far from the West Side docks where many of the runaways turn tricks to survive. I'm Shahab Sharify reporting.
And Shahab Sharify reports, New Yorkers who feel the pain prayed for the victim.
Tonight at the Church of Heavenly Rest on the Upper East Side, a prayer service for the young woman who was viciously beaten and gang raped on Wednesday night. As New Yorkers pray for her survival, the 28-year-old investment banker is fighting for her life at the Metropolitan Hospital. She's suffering from brain damage and remains in critical condition. So far, 8 teenagers have been arrested. They're mostly 14 and 15 years old. They're charged with attempted murder, assault, and rape. Police say a gang of 12 attacked the victim on Wednesday night while she was jogging in Central Park. Today, joggers seemed more cautious. This runner brought along her husband. She usually runs alone.
It's frightening. Anything can happen and no one will hear you.
It was such a horrific attack and such a vicious and violent attack that I don't think anyone can really understand how bad it was.
Raleigh Mayer perhaps understands better than most people. She was raped 7 years ago right here in Central Park. The jogger wasn't the only victim that night. Earlier, police believe that a gang of 30 broke up into smaller factions to attack 8 people. They robbed an elderly man, they threw rocks at a cab and a couple bicycling. They used a pipe to attack a man who was jogging. It was a night of terror for the victims and a night of wild thrills and excitement for the gang. The crime spree lasted 2 hours. The gang from Harlem has told the police that they were going wilding that night, which means they went out looking for trouble. Police say it's another way of saying
that we're going to go raise hell.
I think these young people don't feel attached to society or perhaps to other people in the right kind of way, so that they easily set aside their conscience and feelings take over, without respect for people, property, or the rules of society.
While the victim remains in critical condition, the police are continuing to question the suspects. They expect to make more arrests in this vicious crime. In Central Park, I'm Shahab Sharify reporting.
How would you like a playmate who looks just like you? Shahab Sharify met 300 or so who grew up seeing double, and it left Shahab feeling a little bit left out.
No, do not touch your television set. You do not need glasses. You are not seeing double. What you are seeing is the 54th annual International Twins Association Convention, where more than 150 sets of twins competed in a look-alike contest today. You look alike, and today you're dressed alike.
We usually do when we come to these conventions or any twin get-together, because we feel that we're special. Anybody can be an individual, but not anybody can be a twin.
Meet John and William Wright. John's on the left. Or is he on the right? Anyway, these identical twins have been going to twin conventions for 33 years. But the Jones twins, Jeff and Jeremy, don't ask me which is which, are newcomers.
It's fun. You're a twin. Yeah.
Agree?
Yeah.
You guys agree with each other mostly?
Yeah.
I don't think you agree. Do you?
Yeah, he agrees.
There were dozens of categories in this look-alike contest, from the youngest set of twins to the oldest. Warren and Wayne DeBeauclair were the oldest men. They're 75.
So how does it feel being a winner?
Great, great, great.
The oldest twins attending this year's convention were Doris and Dorothy Yates, with a combined age of 162 years.
It's great. It's a gift that money can't buy. It's the best thing that ever happened to us.
Dr. Jane Greer, a twin consultant, says twins have a special bond that starts even before they're born.
And it's about the experience of sharing that goes on throughout their life, and a partnership that develops out of the sharing that gives them a unique intimacy of one another.
Have you ever dated a twin?
Yes, we have dated three sets of twins. One set, we switched on them, and we went roller skating, and up to this day, they don't know that we ever switched on.
And Helen Manners is the twin of Helen Ann Manners. If that's not confusing enough, their respective husbands look alike, even though they're not related.
They do look alike, so that's all right with us. That's okay with us.
Coming to an event like this kind of makes me wish I had a twin, just looking around, seeing everyone paired up. Well, not everyone is paired up. I must be seeing things.
I'm Shahab Sharify reporting. When I first saw Willie, he was fast asleep taking his afternoon nap. A styrofoam cup with some change lay at his side. I didn't know what to expect when I approached him. Would he attack me? How would he respond to this intruder who was trespassing on his property, the sidewalk on 30th Street? But when Willie's eyes opened, a gentle smile appeared. It was his way of saying, "Welcome." Before the casket was brought into the church, Hatcher's wife showed her oldest son, Zachary, how to salute. He stood at attention. She stood motionless, her right hand over her heart. Her three-year-old son, Joshua, stood nearby, too young to salute, and perhaps too young to comprehend what has happened to his father. When we took off, we pulled straight up to 15,000 feet in what seemed like a split second. It was probably more like 7 or 8 seconds. I thought, so this is what paradise looks like. For years, the residents of East New York have sat back and helplessly watched the infiltration of crack ruin their neighborhood. Abandoned buildings are used as crack houses. Mom-and-pop grocery stores are fronts for drug dens. But now they say they've had enough. They're mad as hell, and they're not going to take it anymore. Even the normally mild-mannered Reverend Elijah Pope is fed up. With a baseball bat in hand, he is literally trying to destroy this crack house. His message is simple. Crack dealers, beware.
That's what we are. We all want a love bizarre.
Survival. That's why they're out there. That's why Melinda works even the coldest nights.
What's it like working out here?
I guess like every other job.
Yeah.
And what are you, a writer?
Yeah, as a matter of fact.
I wanted to do my life story.
Sure.
Quite interesting.
Yeah, what's your name?
Melinda.
Melinda?
Mm-hmm.
So what's your life story?
We can't go into it just a couple of minutes.
Yeah.
Do you want to come or what?
That's what we are. We
all want a love bizarre.
If you weren't out here working, what would you be doing?
Marketing and business management.
Marketing, business management?
And business
management. And business management.
I'm in school for that.
Yeah. But so why aren't you doing it? Why are you doing this?
Pay my way.
All right. See ya. Melinda? Melinda? Okay. Bye-bye. John.
John, right?
See you later.